Hi, window watchers. See what I'm pointing at right here? Can you see something dark inside the net? I have the butterfly net that we made right up here. And just a few minutes ago, this insect came flying around in here. And so we hurry up and put the butterfly net over him. And now, Tiny Gunderson, why don't you tell us what to do with him?
Well, now, you see, this is a wasp. Uh-huh. So you don't want to be careless about this business of getting the wasp into your net or into a killing jar, see? Uh-huh. You do it carefully because you don't want poor things all tangled up in your cheesecloth. In fact, it's got its mouth.
It's biting it.
It's just biting that cheesecloth as hard as it can bite. And now there is no insect killer in this jar, so
I didn't have my my killing jar here.
The only thing we can do is try to persuade this wasp to get to turn loose. Maybe we can't even do that, but I'll tell you what we can do.
If
there were carbon tetrachloride in the jar, then the wasp would soon die and drop off.
Uh-huh.
And you haven't hurt your net a bit.
Oh, he's in there though.
Oh. You know, I think another thing that we'd better do is...
There he is. See?
Good. Well, now we'll perform a death-defying stunt here. Or a sting-defying stunt. Getting the net out of the jar, or the jar out of the net, and there is our wasp. Poor little thing, it's kind of...
Probably scared
shocked.
Half to death.
Yes, I think it is. You know, that's one reason why wasps sting. They're afraid of you.
Oh, well, I'm more or less afraid of them if they're going to be stingy, too.
But you see, they don't know what you're going to do. So when you shriek and run when you see a wasp or a bee, the wasp or the bee figures that you're going to attack it. So,
leave him alone.
Wham, it gets you first.
I see.
Well, now the thing,
we're
taking the pins out of the wings, you remember?
Uh-huh.
Oh. There we are.
There we are. So
now,
we put it in the mounting box here.
There is Sunny's tiger moth. And we will put a label on it here. You always want to label your bugs.
Uh-huh.
And we'll put it right into the box. Hey, you've got a nice bug collection started there.
Yeah. Maybe
that's
by the
really
end of the
nice.
Summer I'll have two boxes full of these.
I hope so, because you'll have to keep up with the window watchers that are collecting cigar boxes full of bugs.
I'm going to try to keep up with them.
This fall, we want to spend a lot of time identifying the insects that you have collected.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll work on that.
Well, now last week, Tiny, you told us that you were going to have some social mm-hmm. termites.
Social insects.
Insects.
And they are termites.
And they are termites. Are they in there?
Yep, they're right in here. Now, a social insect is, by definition, an insect where there are castes, where the different castes each do a different type of work. And while we have all of those castes in this termite jar, you might say, we have a film which shows termites much closer up than anything we could show you here. So let's look at the film and see what termites really look like. Now this is an ordinary steel pin in the center of the picture there.
Uh-huh.
And those are termite workers just sort of crawling around. They're not quite sure what they're supposed to be doing there. Actually, they're posing for their picture, but they didn't know that.
Well, this is just a sewing pin. Is that really the size
yeah.
of the termite
mm-hmm.
pin?
Now you see. There's a termite just crossing the head of the pin, and you can see that it's about, three or four times as long as the pin is wide.
They have six legs, too.
They have six legs, just like all other insects, and they have antennae. You notice those two termites there that
uh-huh.
are sort of biting one another?
Is that what they're doing?
No. They're actually either communicating or cleaning one another.
Oh.
And there's a little termite crawling up to see what that big steel pin is. You notice that the little termite looks like the big termite, except that it's smaller. The reason is that termites hatch from eggs, And they look just like the adult.
Oh, I see. They
don't go through the egg, larva, pupa, and adult stage like butterflies. But those things are tremendously old in point of years, and they are among the most interesting, I think, of the insects.
Well, now you said that they had casting, did you say?
No,
they
no.
had caste system to their society or something
yeah,
like that?
Yeah, now of course, we're talking about the way we classify things. I don't know whether the termites really believe that you're a worker and I'm a soldier and she's a queen. I don't think they think about it.
They
just
do their job.
They just do their job, and the job of the worker is different from that of the soldier.
Well, now, the ones that we just looked at on this film, the white ones, they were workers, you see.
Yes.
Well, how can we tell the difference between a worker and the queen or what's
well,
the other kind?
Well, I have a picture which shows the three castes of termites. The winged adult, which is the sexual form, the one that lays the eggs,
uh-huh.
that's over on the right. That's the one that has the wings. The soldier is in the center. It has a big, strong head and very huge jaws. And the worker is over at the left of the screen, perhaps a little slenderer, and certainly it has a smaller head. But those are the three castes, and each caste has its own job,
just
like all of the other social insects.
Mm-hmm. Well, now, are they all white like the worker?
The queen, the winged adult,
uh-huh.
is black,
is
but the rest of them are white or light yellow like these here.
Uh-huh. But the black ones, or the ones that have wings, are the only black ones. Are those the ones that we see, or do
no.
we see the white ones?
You rarely will see the queen except during swarming, and swarming is going on right now. The winged adults are coming out in basements, in garages, out of doors, and you'll see a large number, sometimes as much as a double handful of these winged termites just milling around on the ground or in the basement.
They stay close to the ground then?
Oh yeah, and they mate and fly away, and then after they've found a suitable place to start a new colony, they lose their wings. They actually break them off.
Do they do it themselves,
mm-hmm.
or do they just break them off?
They do it themselves. And then the queen termite has to do her own housework for a while, while she lays eggs to produce workers to do the housework for her. Sure.
Oh,
then after the workers get started, the queen settles down to her major business, which is producing eggs.
That's all she has to do.
That's all she does. All day long, day after day, year after year. I imagine it gets kind of tiresome after
well,
a while if they think
year
about
after
it.
Year, how long do termites live?
Well, no one knows for sure. Worker termites have been kept alive for 7 years.
7 years?
And queens probably live longer than that.
Isn't that a long time for an insect to live?
Oh, yes. That wasp, for example, will live for about a month, 6 weeks.
That's all. But 7 years. How old are they anyway? I mean, how long have they existed?
Oh, they've been on Earth for at least 200 million years, because termites almost identical with these have been found in rocks. Fossil termites have been found in the rocks
uh-huh.
that are 200 million years old. So they are ancient.
It's a long time ago.
Yeah.
Well, now you said that the soldier termites protected the colony
mm-hmm.
from their enemies. Well, what's
That's
the
right.
enemy of the termite?
The worst enemy is ants, because ants and termites both live in the ground. They both may try to occupy the same space, and when that happens, of course, there's always a fight.
Mm-hmm.
And the termites can hold their own pretty well, especially these big soldiers with their big jaws.
Well, just how can you tell the difference between termites and ants?
Well, we have a slide which shows the termite and the ant, and I think perhaps we'd better look at that right now. At the left is the winged termite, at the right the winged ant. Both of them may have wings, they both have six legs, but the main difference between them is the fact that the ant has a wasp waist, a constriction between
the skinny part,
between the thorax and the abdomen. The termite doesn't have that constriction. So that wherever you see a termite or an insect that looks something like an ant in the soil or in wood,
probably,
and it doesn't have that constriction and is white, that's a termite.
That's a termite.
Ants are black or red or brown.
Well, now, you find them in the wood, you say. What do they eat?
Well, they'll eat anything that contains cellulose. Now, here is something that termites have eaten. This is a pad of paper.
Oh, I see. And they eat paper because paper's made out of crushed up wood.
And here is a piece of wood that termites have eaten. They will also eat cotton because cotton contains cellulose.
Mm-hmm.
So those are the things that termites eat.
Boy, they certainly have done a good job on this piece
of
wood here.
And you notice they eat this out, and they leave the hard annual rings because those are just too tough for their jaws. They swallow the wood that they eat, and then in their stomachs they have little bugs, little one-celled organisms that digest that wood so that the termite can utilize it.
That's kind of a good deal, and they eat their food and somebody else eats it again for them, huh?
That's right, or somebody breaks it down for them so that they can utilize it.
Well, that's not bad at all. I see you have this piece of wood here. This just fascinates me now.
Well, now that is the corner of a baseboard along the floor, and from the outside you see it looks all right because termites rarely break through, but on the inside you notice it's all eaten out. That was a 1-inch piece of wood originally, and the termites just ate everything except that little bit.
I thought a wall board around the bottom of my walls, I could put almost 2 fingers across.
That's
there.
That's just about right.
There's not anywhere near enough room for 2 fingers. Well, then, do they live in this wood?
Yes, but they come to the wood, but they have their nest in the soil, deep in the soil.
Where could we find some?
Well, the first place would be to look in a stump. We have a picture of that. Here's an old stump that is really swarming with termites. You break that open and you've got termites enough for several termite colonies.
Uh-huh.
Or we have another picture showing a termite tube. Now this tube is just an earthen tube that runs along the wall leading from the soil where they live to the wood where they're going to eat. And you might call that a superhighway for termites. It's enclosed and it's sheltered, so they don't have any difficulty at all.
Oh, I see. Well, could we make a termite jar like this?
Sure. Just find your termites by putting out a piece of wood or by looking in a stump or by breaking open a tube. Put some dirt and the termites in a jar. Put a cellulose sponge in to provide moisture because they must have that. And there's your nest.
I see. Well, what are you going to have for us next week?
Next week it's going to be ants, and Earl Ron will be here to talk about ants with you and the window watch.
Well, good then. You come on back next week, and Mr. Ron will be talking about ants. We'll see you again. Okay? Goodbye.